Well, hello friends, and welcome back to the Cattleman's Corner, a video series highlighting the beef industry. Throughout the show, I've been visiting with extension specialists, producers, and members of allied industry just about pertinent topics as we see them through the calendar year. Today, I'm with a friend, a mentor, and of course, our K-State Research and Extension beef state veterinarian, AJ Tarpoff. AJ, thanks for joining us.
Barrett, it's a pleasure to be here.
Real quick, most of you have probably interacted with him at some point, but for those that haven't, Doc, maybe just give us a quick overview or introduction of yourself and kind of your overview as the state beef vet.
Absolutely. So here at K-State, I'm the beef extension veterinarian for the state. I'm housed in the animal science department here on main campus in Manhattan, Kansas. I really enjoy this position because I don't have many constraints of what I get to do. Every day is a little bit different. I work heavily with the extension service, with agents like Barrett, that I get an opportunity to work with all our local assets that are throughout the state and every county of Kansas. So I work heavily with extension. We do a lot of producer meetings, kind of further education, so to speak, for mm-hmm. our producers out in the field. I also work with a lot of practicing veterinarians through the state. And that's kind of my extension, my outreach type, my outreach service that I provide for the state of Kansas. Here on main campus, I also have a teaching and a research appointment. So I do have an opportunity to interact and to work with graduating seniors in animal science, do a little work with some master's students, as well as I do some guest lectures over in the veterinary school. And on my research side, it's really focused on practical, hands-on, applied research that can really impact producers.
You bet. And we're fortunate to have AJ kind of fill those many different roles for us and like I said, can kind of be seen out and about, particularly from an extension standpoint. And we wanted to pick his brain here today on some different things, namely cattle health pertinent to the summer season. And so with that, I think there's a couple things that probably come to most folks' mind, and we've talked about them briefly, but things like pink eye and things like foot rot. And I think we're probably going to see a fair bit of those cases or issues come up, given the wetness and the moisture that we have and are currently sitting in as we kind of enter the summer season. So, Doc, maybe let's just talk about some clinical signs or producers, again, many are familiar with this and can recognize it, but let's start there at the top and kind of work our way through both pink eye and foot rot.
Okay, so let's start with pink eye. So pink eye, have you ever poked yourself in the eye?
Sure.
Or gotten something stuck in your eye? You're blinking constantly, tears start to come down. That is the basic innate immune response, that the tears are a protective layer over the cornea or the clear area of the eye. And unfortunately what happens with pink eye is we have an abrasion, we have irritation and inflammation on that cornea and the surrounding conjunctiva, which is kind of the tissue that surrounds the eye. When that happens, it's painful. It is a very painful condition. So what we see with cattle, in particular, it's really easy to see on light-faced, light-heighted colored animals because we'll see the tearing coming down the side of the face. And with those tears, it's high in protein and things of that nature. We'll see dirt, dust, things of that nature kind of congregate on the side of the face in some of those tearing secretions. So when we see that, we can see them from afar. We see them, they're constantly blinking, but we got to keep in mind cattle are a prey species. They like to hide their issues or their ailments from us. So these are the animals within our herd while we're moving animals. They always stay to one side of us. They don't want to show us that one eye. It's a good idea that when we're out checking cows, when we're checking our pasture animals, make sure we go out of our way to see both sides of the animal and have them look at us. The more that we're in and amongst working through our animals, whether it's on a four-wheeler, whether it's on horseback, on foot, getting those animals comfortable with us. And when they're comfortable with us, that they're less likely to hide some of their ailments from us. So that's pink eye. So that's easy. Constant blinking, tearing. That's pretty self-explanatory. Mm-hmm. I'm sure we've all seen some of those issues. Foot rot. Now, foot rot, on the other hand, can show several different stages of problems. Now, what happens with foot rot is lameness. Okay, and we can have more than one limb, one foot affected. What happens with foot rot is we have a breakdown in the protective skin layer, okay? Usually between the toes that we get a crack. Well, the bacteria that's in the environment and in the soil that's constantly there actually gets in that crack and forms some pretty big inflammation and infection just underneath the skin. So it's, you know, we talk about sub-Q injections, subcutaneous injections mm-hmm. for when we're giving vaccines. Well, the inflammation and infection starts just sub-Q, okay? And that's where we get the swelling. Usually the swelling, if this is the back of the hoof with the dew claws, we see swelling begin just underneath the dew claws above the hooves. That's where we see the swelling initiate. Once that starts, these animals will not be three-legged lame, but they will start to show a little bit of favoritism on that limb because it is a painful condition as well. As it progresses, the swelling does go in between the toes. We get kind of a splitting of the toes, big swollen foot. And I think most of our producers can appreciate the smell that is associated mm-hmm. with that. So we get swelling that starts on the backside, comes underneath the foot, and then the entire foot can actually show signs of swelling. It's uniform, okay? So the entire foot will show the same amount of swelling. That is our typical foot rot. As it progresses, it can unfortunately get into underlying tissues, causing a little bit more of a problem.
Sure.
But those are the basic clinical signs of both foot rot and pink eye.
And so I've got, visiting with some folks that have started to graze some cattle, whether you're out to grass with pairs or maybe a little bit more commonly running in on lighter weight calves in that scenario, or just grazing some yearlings, that sort of thing, particularly on the pink eye side, and they think, you know, we're potentially over-doctoring, or, you know, maybe doing something like that. And I think it's important to note, one, your vaccine cost, even when it climbs a little bit, is certainly cheaper than death loss. And two, you mentioned some of the clinical signs of pink eye. It's important to be able to determine when that eye's dried up. You know, if maybe it's potentially been a while since we were out in the cattle, or if you're in a multi-person operation and dad goes out there and sees it right off the bat and has gone ahead and doctored the animal and they're starting to dry up. Lots of times they'll still have that clump or that dirt accumulated you know, are we going to over-doctor him again, or well, he's just not healing up? Well, once it's dry, it's dead, correct?
It is. So, one thing that everybody's on the same page that I'm a big proponent of when it comes to pink eye is eye patches, okay? We talked mm-hmm. about how irritating that eye is. If you've ever had an issue with your eye, do you like going out in the sunlight?
Or
having the breeze blow through it, or if it gets dusty and we're constantly squinting. That one thing that we can all appreciate is, you know, that irritation that can just happen from the sun, the UV radiation, dust, wind, things of that nature. That to help increase the comfort of these animals, I've always been a big proponent of eye patches. So if we are going to capture, we're going to treat these animals, while we have them restrained, it's a good idea to use some tag glue and actually apply an eye patch over that eye. Helps protect against the UV radiation, helps protect against any dust, debris, wind that blows mm-hmm. through, but also from some of the external parasites. In means of the over-doctoring, as long as we get them doctored early, okay, so we can get them captured, get them doctored early, we protect that eye from some of the elements for a period of time, that whenever we remove it, most time that we don't need a secondary or tertiary, you know, third mm-hmm. type of treatment, that we can get, they should heal pretty well with one treatment. Now, that treatment, work closely with your local practitioner, your local veterinarian. They understand those pink eye issues that are going through your specific area. Work with them and kind of create a pink eye protocol and be prepared and have the tools on hand to be able to treat these animals appropriately whenever it happens.
So quick question, more for curiosity's sake than anything on my part, eye bath or eye wash before the eye patch goes on or something. Your thoughts, reason behind it, does it work type situation?
Yeah, so the eye wash, from the issues with the eye, we have to think about where these animals are grazing. If in order for pink eye to occur, we have to have a breakdown in that protective coating of the eye, and where we actually get a physical abrasion or a scratch on that cornea. And that's what initiates, you know, that these bacteria that cause pink eye to take a hold and actually cause that issue. So what can cause that? Well, think about grass awns, okay? Grazing through tall grass, a little bit of brushy material. As they're grazing through, they get a scratch or a scrape on their eye. Well, sometimes it's actually a foreign body. Okay, so we can actually have a foreign body or a little grass on from the tip of the grass, some of the grass seed can unfortunately get stuck on the inside of the eyelid. So eye washing, or at least checking to make sure there's not a foreign body floating around underneath the eyelid, can really help recovery rate, because we don't have a constant irritation that's still damaging the eye while we're trying to get it through treatment.
Sure, sure. And a little bit on that, I know you mentioned, and maybe I just ask you to stress it again or say it a little bit louder, early treatment with prevention, those are going to be the keys, especially with pink, really with both pink eye and foot rot, as we're fixing to talk about maybe, but maybe just touch on that again quick.
Yeah, so the case of disease, so the progression of disease, it gets worse and worse. Okay, so the longer we wait, the more damage that can actually happen to the eye. What initially happens, the tearing, the inflammation, if we catch them early, okay, they can respond pretty well, and we can get back to regular health. The eye goes back to normal, everything's great. As the disease progresses, unfortunately, we get direct damage to the cornea. The clear area of the eye, we can actually get an ulcer, where we break down the entire cornea. We have this big ulceration that is, it causes a lot of inflammation, causes a lot of irritation to that animal, and that actually puts the eye at risk. Unfortunately, if it progresses further from the ulcer, that ulcer can actually, it can open, okay, where we can actually have a perforated eye. Mm-hmm. Once that happens, you know, that eye is no longer functional, but it is a source of severe inflammation and irritation to that animal. Some of those eyes, work with your veterinarian that we can remove that source of irritation so those animals can go back to regular production.
Gotcha. So, Doc, I want to, get back to the other big topic that we wanted to visit about today, and the foot health or foot rot side of things. And you kind of walked us through pretty much basically clinical signs and how and why that occurs. Oftentimes we think of it, as I mentioned at the top of the show, wet weather, lots of moisture, and then even lots of times when things get super wet. And then as we hope, we kind of can mellow out moving forward. But if it really gets hot and dry, and then that ground gets tremendously hard, then we can really see some of those negative aspects of basically being soft-footed pretty much come through. So maybe just hit a little bit more on some of the, not necessarily the causes of foot rot, but when to watch for it, and then, of course, how to go through with some treatment options as well.
Well, Barry, you brought up a great point. Environment, okay? Moisture levels. The skin is a phenomenal barrier, okay? Just think about the thickness of the hide of a cow, okay? That's a great barrier from the outside element. Now, what can irritate or what can disrupt that protective skin layer? Okay, well, we talked about moisture. We can have softening of the hide itself. Okay, so once we get things soft, think about being in a swimming pool for a long period of time. Your skin gets kind of soft and wrinkly. Well, the same thing can happen for cattle that are in very moist environments. Also, think about the winter with very low humidity. What do we usually get? We get chapped lips that can crack and bleed. So those are two kind of extremes, either very wet or very dry, where we can either have dry cracking of the foot, or we can have wet softening of that tissue layer that leads to, okay, well, things start to dry up. Mud turns to almost as hard as concrete, that we have unlevel areas where they walk through, and what happens? It pushes in between the two toes, where we can get a crack, we can get an abrasion, we can get a scratch in between the two toes. And that's kind of where things start to initiate and causes some of that damage. So yes, environment, moisture, humidity, all play a key role in foot health. Now, can we always control the environment? Can we control how much water comes down from the sky? No, we can't. So we do need to be realistic about that. But keep in mind, we can modify the environment in certain locations that right now, if we start to dry up over the next few weeks, we have an opportunity that if we do have some very rough, uneven ground, we've all seen those areas where cattle frequent that we have multiple hoof prints that almost turn to concrete with some sharp edges, that we can go in and knock off some of those edges, either drag something behind a four-wheeler, we can use a lot of different, some facilities have an opportunity to use something like a box blade where we can scrape off those sharp points. We do that routinely in confinement operations and feedlots, that if we get some of that really rough area, that we can just knock off the edges where they have those animals have a nice smooth area to walk through.
And one thing, we're seeing more and more of, particularly on pasture, is the access to be able, or the ability to be able to fence off ponds or watering mm-hmm. systems and utilize some solar pumps and things like that. Not only for the longevity of the watering system, which as a producer that's paying for dirt work or whatever, that certainly makes things a lot more manageable, but also as a way to keep those cattle out of the water, mm-hmm. As we talked about, when it does get hot and awfully tempting to mm-hmm. them. So treatment options as far as foot health goes and keeping their wheels underneath them, same applies as you already mentioned, early and better to be too often than not at all. Any further comments in that regard?
The biggest thing with foot rot that I see is, getting the animals up and moving them. Okay. I know we all get, we're habitual creatures. Okay. We're creatures of habit, just like cattle. And sometimes when we're out checking our animals, we're checking the water source, we're checking our mineral. We go out to check the animals, we get a good herd count, making sure everything matches, making sure everybody's where they should be. But sometimes we forget to get these animals to stand up and physically move them around to make sure that they don't have a limping lameness. Again, an animal that has a sore foot, they want to go lay down, okay? And whether that's our cows, our bulls, our stocker animals, think about our bulls. If they're laying down under the shade, we think, okay, life is good. If they have an ailment like a foot rot issue and we don't get it addressed appropriately, that bull's not going to be out doing his job
sure.
during the breeding season. Every time, trying to get in the habit of every time we check our cows, making sure that we stand them up, we move them as a group so we can pinpoint any outliers that may have a lameness issue. So that will lead to an early treatment. But again, have a game plan in place. Okay, we have a lot of phenomenal products that are available that are labeled for foot rot. Work with your local veterinarian. There are certain products they may recommend within your operation that works within the confines of your operation. Also, our pasture animals. Okay, how are we going to be able to properly treat these animals? Do we have portable pens? Do we have an area that we can capture them? Do we have something that, not necessarily moving an animal to a catch pen, but do we have another option to take our treatment to the animal so they don't have to walk as far? Whether that's a horse and a rope, whether that's a portable pen, there's a lot of options that are available that we can treat these animals out in the pasture. So my biggest recommendation, don't wait till the last minute. Have a game plan in place that we know if foot rot occurs, especially this year with the given environment and everything else, making sure that we have that plan in place so whenever the issue arises, we can act on that plan immediately.
And I'll just echo your last point. I thought that was a great way there to sum it up. There's a lot of ways to skin a cat as far as treatment goes. And your neighbor may think, well, he's not doing it appropriately. I can't see how he can get out there and doctor effectively and vice versa. But I think the bottom line is whatever as a producer you're most comfortable with and most efficient with is going to create the least amount of stress on the animal. And like you mentioned, if you're pretty good with a horse and a rope and can really do that effectively, that'll work. Mm-hmm. If a catch pen is your best option, that's certainly better than going out and throwing five or six loops and getting everybody sweaty and mad, right? And so kind of weigh those options. You guys know as producers where your strengths lie, and if it's not broke, don't fix it would be,
Whatever means that we can do it, calm, cool, and collected, that's the best mode of action to try to get those treatments effectively in those animals.